Good morning and a warm welcome to the 13th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to take item 3 and 4 in private? Okay. Thank you. Our second agenda item is to continue to take evidence in the committee's inquiry on the review of the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement. This morning, we are joined remotely by Mike Buckley, Director, Independent Commission on UK-EU Relations, Peter Holmes, Emeritus Fellow of the UK Trade Policy Observatory, the University of Sussex, David Hamilton, Student in Bioeconomy, Innovation and Governance at the University of Edinburgh, and we're hoped to be joined by Anna Serduska, Director of Trade and Borders. And all of our panel this morning are members of the Independent Commission on UK-EU Relations think tank. So a warm welcome. If I could ask a question before to start us off today. In your Brexit and goods report, you say an effective way to ensure a smooth and affordable flow of goods trade would be via mutual recognition schemes, although it's likely that the UK would have to make standards concessions to achieve this. And you also suggest that regulatory divergence would present challenges for exporting businesses. I wonder if you could maybe just elaborate on those thoughts and how you think standards concessions and what would is meant by standards concessions, so we're absolutely clear on that. And if I could go first to Mike Buckley, please.
But I would say also go to Peter and David, who are more expert in the trade area than I, but I'll give you the overview. I think in terms of mutual recognition, we all want to see trade flow more freely. And indeed, we will all be aware, I would imagine, on this call and in the room that you're in, that trade barriers have inhibited the UK economy, have inhibited the Scottish economy, and have inhibited our ability to trade with our closest trading partners. And that is a significant inhibitor for the economy. And that has a consequence impact, of course, for businesses, for employment, for wages, and for our ability to grow the Scottish economy and the UK economy more broadly. So to take those trade barriers down, to do anything to make them reduce is a big ask because of the way that the Trade and Cooperation Agreement was put together. Recognition of standards is one thing that can help make that happen, but that will mean essentially the UK deciding we will follow EU rules so that our standards meet their standards. Now, in reality, that's less of a big ask than it would first appear, because in reality, businesses in the UK who want to export to the EU already have to produce to EU standards. But the great difficulty is that just producing to EU standards does not, in and of itself, take down those trade barriers, because in the single market, trade can flow freely, goods can flow freely, and they don't have to produce any evidence when they approach national borders that they have produced to EU standards because they've all agreed to do so. So they have that trust, if you like. But because we're no longer part of that system, even if in the UK or Scotland we did produce to those standards, we still have to show a piece of paper at the border to say that we have produced to those standards. So those trade barriers remain. But in terms of divergence, what that of course means is that in the UK we do something different to what happens in the EU. And while in some ways it's only been a short amount of time since we left the European Union, it's only been, you know, four years, nonetheless, divergence is happening partly because of decisions made by the UK government, but also, of course, the EU is not a static body. It has also been making changes to the way that it operates and to the way it operates into its own standards and procedures. So even if we stay static, they will be making changes. So the only way to ensure that trade barriers can be minimised to the greatest possible extent is for us to have what is called dynamic alignment, which means that we essentially take note of the changes that they are making and the new rules and regulations and standards that they're bringing in for products, for example. And it means that we would need to choose to follow that, which does, in the end, bring us back around almost to the old Brexit debates of do we want to be a rule taker as a country, which is politically unpalatable, but maybe economically necessary.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I ask Mr. Holmes, please?
Thank you very much indeed. It's a great pleasure to be with you. When it comes to the report, Mike's the person who can really talk to you about it. I'm a bit of a standards nerd, though, so if I could go into a little bit more detail on what he's been saying to elaborate on some of the difficulties that lie behind the issue. The first thing we have to do is to distinguish between standards, regulations, conformity assessment and accreditation. Policy, we frequently talk about standards to cover the whole range of these things, but actually the UK a couple of years ago did formally agree to continue its membership of the European standards bodies. Standards are kind of definitions, an inch, a kilogram. It's somewhere in Paris, there's a block of platinum that weighs exactly 1 kilogram. There's no legal basis, but it's, what is a kilogram? It's what this thing is, and now it's done more electronically. But standards are just standards, and we are legally obliged under the membership of the standards organizations to use the same standards as the rest of continental Europe. But that, as Mike was stressing, doesn't actually do anything to eliminate trade barriers, because what you have to comply with to get transit without difficulty across a border is compliance with regulations. And regulations, the WTO rules say regulations should, where possible, be based on standards. But there's a gap, there's a little edge between the standard and the regulation. And we have to align our regulations, our statutes, not just the standards. And then, as Mike was suggesting, pointing out, it's not enough simply to have a law that says we are going to align our rules with the EU rules. You have to have an enforcement mechanism which guarantees this. Now, I imagine after the building, after the Grenfell fire disaster, a British manufacturer of building materials bringing their truck to Calais and say, well, look, these have met British standards and they comply with British regulations and they've been inspected by the finest British inspectors that we have. The French customs guy will say, well, yeah, hang on, monsieur. I think I'd just like to look at one or two of these bricks to make sure that they aren't falling apart. So, and in the EU system, one of the things that really that ties it all together, the EU standards ecosystem, is that in addition to every country having to have the same conformity assessment rules, the testing rules, there's something called an accreditation regime where the EU has legally binding rules which force countries to get their conformity assessment testing accredited by an EU recognised body. And that's the problem, that at the moment, if you want to sell anything into the EU, you have to get a certificate issued by an EU accredited conformity assessment body. And that it could mean actually the British Standards Institute's Netherlands office. It could be the German TÜV office. It could be the French standards agency. But the British bodies registered in Britain are not authorised to issue certificates which guarantee conformity with the EU. And that's where the sovereignty thing comes in. It's no good promising dynamic alignment, passing a law. Now, a colleague on the commission, George Peretz, has pointed out practically quite a difficult matter to do it. You actually have to kind of replicate the regulations, and when you're not actually involved in the design process of the regulations, it's actually kind of mimicking what they've done. It involves a bit of work. The EU frequently has regulations imposed through the system of a directive. There's an EU-level directive which then requires certain conditions on national standards. Well, we're not national regulations. We're not in that system. And I've been talking to people in the DBT and the Office of Standards, actually, about how difficult it is for them to actually check exactly how the EU works when they're not part of the regulatory system. They are in the standards system, and that's something we should take advantage of. But the EU historically has been very reluctant to extend the principle of mutual recognition to countries that don't bind themselves to accepting the EU, the whole EU package, including conformity assessment rules are the same, and an accreditation system that guarantees the value of the conformity assessment. And that, of course, subject to the Court of Justice. And that's what the EEA, European Economic Area regime, does. And it's sort of messily implicated in Northern Ireland. I mean, some of what goes on in Northern Ireland could perhaps give us a clue as to how we can make it work in the rest of the... I mean, I hate to say that maybe we should go back to Theresa May's strange hybrid backstop model. But how you actually make this work in detail is very complicated. I know I've been talking for a very long time, but you know, I don't often get a chance to talk to people who are interested in this. If I could just mention one last thing. At the time the Windsor Agreement was signed, I had an email from a very old friend who's a very, very senior negotiator in the European Commission. And he said, Peter, now that things are moving closer, the one thing we really need to pay attention to is accidental divergence. As Mike was saying, if the UK simply fails to spot that the EU has very slightly changed the way pressure bags are tested, or what pressure they have to have for cars, airbags, then and doesn't require the UK car industry to make them in exactly the same way, enforced, that's going to completely block all car sales to the EU. And the UK has to keep chasing, it has to keep track, it has to keep watching. And if it accidentally fails to align a thing with what the EU is doing, then it runs the risk of blocking a whole flow of exports. So, I mean, I'm sorry, I could go on for a lot longer, but I'll shut up now. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I've still to bring in some of the panel, Mr. Stewart, but I will come back to you. Mr. Hamilton.
Good morning. Good morning. It's quite something to be here. I'm just going to provide the committee with a little more background information about myself. So officially, I'm a student, but I'm actually a senior student. I'm actually a trade economist. I've worked in Canada in my home, as well as the World Trade Organization. So I'm not a stranger to any of these themes. So I was trying to figure out how to add in after Peter Verhoeven's wonderful testimony there. My work predominantly at the WTO mainly focused on small, medium-sized enterprises. So when it comes to standards and regulations, it's not just about how they get made. It's also how we ensure that companies of any size, the real test is the smaller ones, can actually comply with those regulations or standards that are based on those regulations and be able to export and pursue the opportunities that are available to them. So instead of reiterating what's been said, I'm going to add, and I think that would be highly beneficial. So the first one that is always a problem is, of course, access to information. If there's a regulation, the companies need to be informed and notified somehow. So the thing is it's not just about having the right dialogue with the EU. It's also about having the right dissemination tools to be able to ensure that the businesses can find that information, can understand it, and know what they need to do. So that's first step. When I was at the WTO, one of my many projects was, for lack of a better word, a Google Maps of trade that was meant to resolve that problem, which is free, but it's probably the first time you guys are hearing about it. It's called the globaltradehelpdesk.org. All one word, Global Trade Help Desk. You type in where you are, you type in where you want to sell, anywhere in the world, you type in what you're selling. And you will get all the information, the market assessment, tariffs, regulations, all the regulatory authorities, all ready to go. This leads into the next problem, which is capacity development. It's not sufficient to have the right tools. This is the problem with our wonderful little tool, the WTO, is we didn't really have the marketing budget to go around with the other organizations we had partnered with to produce it, to talk to the right associations, the right schools, the right departments of government, to say, look, we've developed this wonderful tool to make this happen. And so there are two sides of this issue. There is the somehow having a better dialogue with the European Union, as well as dealing with what's called the Brussels effect, which is the Brussels create a regulation based on a standard. There's going to have to be some degree of compliance, and there are issues with sovereignty in that. But beyond that, there's also the process of getting that information to the company, to the managers, to the people that actually affect the decisions about how a product is made. And that has, it's not just about after the product is being produced in the factory, it comes from the planning. You have to remember that one of the other issues is that we live in a world of global value chains, which as a trade economist is something I really know. And that talks about how companies exist within chains that might be dependent not only on export opportunities in another country, but also might be dependent on sourcing inputs. Those could be raw materials, parts, components, or services coming in from abroad. And the thing is that coming in as well has to be planned on the basis to eventually meet the regulatory compliance requirements of the final destination market. So my end has always been on the actual what happens on the ground angle on this, but I think that gives you a very good picture of what the entire dynamic of the situation is. Thank you very much. One additional thing. My home province in Canada is Nova Scotia, and my hometown hosts the oldest Highland Games outside of Scotland, and it's quite an honour to be here as a Nova Scotia. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that, and you're very welcome in our committee virtually this morning. I've got two members to commend, so I'm going to go to Alexander Stewart and then to Kevin Stewart.
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. You've already touched on some of the report when we talk about regular, you know, the whole alignment and the conformity, and you know, when we touch on rules of origin as well, about how things can be progressed and the challenges that we already face. We know the differences, the standards that we have, and the key standards that need to be agreed. But can I maybe ask about where we see any real opportunities for the UK and the EU to negotiate changes to the TCA, and how effective that could and might be? And if I come to Mr. Buckley first. Sorry.
So thank you for that. And thank you again for having us with you this morning. In terms of my engagement with the EU, so I speak to people from the EU regularly, obviously many based in the UK, the EU delegations to the UK and in embassies. And I do speak to people in Brussels and member state capitals as well, because one of our kind of guiding principles as a commission has been the fact that obviously the debate on the future of the UK-EU relationship has been ongoing in the UK, but very often it's UK person talking to UK person. And indeed, when I do speak to people from the EU about the future, you know, possibilities for the future relationship, they will regularly say to me, you know, we read an article or we read an interview from a UK politician positing some future for the UK-EU relationship, but nobody ever comes and talks to us. So one of our guiding principles has been to build that relationship, partly to take the temperature of views within the EU towards the UK on an ongoing basis, but also because, of course, if change is going to happen, it's going to have to happen because there's a desire for that to happen on the EU side as well. And it's also only going to happen in the context in which trust is rebuilt. And it is certainly the case that, certainly to this point, trust is still very low from the EU towards the UK. I won't mention any individual's names, but I was talking to somebody fairly senior from Brussels a few months ago. And he made the point that the Winterbourne framework for them was an end of a sort of 7-8 year negotiation process, you know, which began when David Cameron first went across to negotiate a new deal with the EU, even before the referendum. So looking back towards 2015, after that, they were in an ongoing negotiation process with the UK, which, for the most part, they did not enjoy. Even after the TCA came into force, they were concerned because of the UK government that we had at the time and the way that they were handling matters, that the UK might renege on that agreement, might open a back door into the single market through the land border in between Northern Ireland and Ireland, might unilaterally change the sea crossing over the Irish Sea. So they had concerns about the relationship up and until the Windsor Framework was signed. It was only at that point that they decided we can now relax, that we can actually trust that the UK is going to fulfil its obligations. So from their perspective, they've only just finished negotiating with the UK. So I think, well, for us, it feels like the TCA has been there for quite some time. We know the impact that it's having on the UK economy. We know the impact is, broadly speaking, negative as compared to the arrangements that we had when we were members of the European Union. And to us, therefore, as the UK, it seems reasonable to think we could renegotiate this agreement and get, from our perspective, a better deal, which would enable our economy to thrive more in the future. But everybody I've spoken to in the EU, by and large, pretty much, is of the view that the TCA is still a very new agreement. They really have no interest in reopening it or renegotiating it. From their perspective, they got everything that they wanted out of the negotiations, which essentially means that they got the level playing field that they wanted, which means that we essentially have to play by their rules. Otherwise, we'll trigger greater trade barriers. So we are essentially held in a bind, which is really not ideal, but that is the outcome that we've got. But the other point that they make, as well as the fact that it's a new agreement, they don't want to go back into negotiations that, from their perspective, they've only just finished. The other point that they make regularly is that they have other priorities. I mean, clearly the war in Ukraine is foremost in people's minds, and I think is a much more present part of people's daily lives in much of Europe than it is in the UK. But it is also much more present in the political circumstances in most European nations. Obviously, most importantly and most obviously, the ones that are proximate to Ukraine, but also in the major capitals in, you know, France, Germany, Spain as well. The war is much more present and is much more of a priority, and the Russian threat feels much more present because there isn't a sea in the way. So there's that. There's also the energy crisis, of course, you know, partly related to the war in Ukraine. There's the climate crisis. Obviously, in the last couple of summers, couple of years, there's been major flooding, there's been major wildfires. So I think that's concentrating a lot of people's minds as well. So the UK is out of sight and out of mind. You know, we're a problem that they dealt with, from their perspective, quite successfully. So we're not really present. Obviously, we're now, you know, 24 hours almost into a UK general election campaign. If the polls are correct, we will almost certainly get a change of government. That will have some impact, I think, in the UK-EU relationship. But certainly what stakeholders in the EU say to me is that it isn't going to transform the relationship overnight. It's not as if they're going to go from viewing the Conservatives as the problem government that is gone and a Labour government comes in and, oh, we like the Labour Party. Well, our red lines are no longer the same. What would you like? You know, come and pick and choose from the single market. That is simply not going to happen, and not by any stretch of the imagination, partly because that just isn't the way the EU operates. Also because one thing that is often forgotten in the UK, I think, is that we are not the only third country relationship that the EU has. So even if it were minded to, you know, bend the rules for the UK, which they're not at all, they won't, because if they do, they will not only have to bend the rules for us, they would also get Turkey knocking on the door, Ukraine knocking on the door, Switzerland knocking on the door, New Zealand knocking on the door. I mean, I could go on. But the point is clear that they have to keep the rules as they are, because there have to be significant advantages to membership, because clearly there are costs to membership. So if they want to maintain the integrity of the single market and the EU, the rules have to be the rules, so they can't bend them, and they won't. But also, even beyond that, even beyond the borders of the EU, they need to effectively mostly treat third countries the same. We are doing a piece of work actually over the summer to look at the EU's third country relationships, because there are differences there. So, for example, I mean, one example, financial services, we've got 3 points of equivalence, I think, with the EU, whereas the United States has 20. There's no reason for that. And it would indeed help financial services here if they could get what the US has got. And there's no reason for that other than the EU just decided to make a different decision. So there are anomalies like that, that it may help the UK to understand, the UK government to understand, so that it can then put that forward. But I think, to go back to your original question, there's a near zero chance that the EU is going to be willing to reopen the TCA in the short to medium term, based on my understanding and from all the conversations I've had with them. But there is a high chance that they will make additions to the TCA or put in place new agreements. And I think the one thing that was helpful, I mean, I'll finish with this. It was only 2 or 3 weeks ago that the EU put forward the idea of a youth mobility scheme. Essentially, the UK was not, we were almost not relevant to that conversation, really. That happened because the current Conservative government has wanted a youth mobility scheme, but has wanted that to be bilateral arrangements between the UK and Germany, between the UK and France, the UK and Spain. Essentially, we wanted to go to the big Western nations that we, in quotes, like, rather than going to the Eastern European nations. However, all of those nations have said, no, this needs to be done at an EU level. But the EU made their offer to the UK, not really because they thought the UK would be interested in their offer at this particular point of our political history, but because they wanted to state very clearly and publicly to the EU27, this is an EU competence, it will be done at EU-wide level, don't entertain any bilateral agreements with the UK. So it was much more a get-in-line member states point from them, rather than a serious offer to the UK, which they expected to be and reciprocated. But I think what is helpful for the UK from that is that it establishes a principle that the EU is interested in significant change to the UK-EU relationship. And I think that is something that A, should give us a lot of hope for the future UK-EU relationship, and B, is something that we can build in the future.
Thank you. Mr. Holmes, do you have any comments on that?
Sorry. Thank you very much. I just want to build on some of the more optimistic elements at the end of what Mike said there. And the first thing to stress is that I completely agree with his fundamental point that it's about trust. There's going to be a period in which we establish trust in the eyes of the EU. I mean, just after the Windsor Agreement, I actually met a fairly senior Irish diplomat who said, well, we actually like what has been agreed here. We don't want to cause trouble in Northern Ireland, but we're a little bit concerned that the British still aren't absolutely sticking to what they've promised in the first place. And there's an element of anxiety about that. The second general point is that we have to think in terms of what can we offer. Going into these discussions with what do we want the EU to give us, and they'll do it because we're not the Conservatives, it's not the way of, it's not going to work. So we have to say what they do want, a youth mobility programme, so we can see what we can build on that. They'd be interested in a sanitary and phytosanitary food safety agreement. If I could just step back a little, though, to look at, you know, the different ways in which you can approach this. As Mike said, the line from the Commission, I've had also sort of direct message from someone within the Commission about how it works. They're not going to change the trade cooperation agreement. That's fixed. They've got a very good deal. They don't want to alter it. But if you look within the TCA, there is a lot of, shall we say, flexibility within it. For example, on rules of origin, the chapter on rules of origin, which says what goods are covered by the free trade agreement and what aren't because they're considered third country goods, that chapter can be amended by the so-called Partnership Council, which is just the politicians and officials meeting from both sides, all sides, member states and the Commission, so on, without it having to go through a treaty renegotiation process. And on electric vehicle rules of origin, on, you know, the Chinese batteries and how they're treated if cars, electric cars, have got Chinese batteries in, that was amended just within the ordinary procedures of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. There are other areas where the Trade and Cooperation Agreement says there shall be negotiations, can be negotiations about certain things. So there's avenues built in there. But I completely agree with what Mike said, that the message I had from the Commission is that they don't want to change the TCA, but they are willing, and the message I was, at any point, to negotiate additional agreements. Now, some of those additional agreements might have a more complicated process than the amendments within the Partnership Council, but the youth mobility thing has been proposed. The sanitary and phytosanitary agreements been proposed. So there is talk of security arrangements. So there's a whole series of things which can be added to the existing arrangement, and they there's scope there. And so, I mean, how to get these things? I mean, clearly there is the procedure of the TCA in which you talk about things. I don't think the committees are meeting as often as they should, but their standards, literally standards, we are members of the European standards bodies. European standards are developed with British input. One of the things I read about in the 1930s was that the British and French were very close on foreign policy, because British diplomats always travelled to Geneva by train, and they got off the train in Paris and met their French counterparts, had little chats. And I think this lack of connection between officials has been a really serious problem. That they don't get off the train in Brussels, they fly over it. They ought to be stopping there, talking, taking part in informal negotiations. This is the case in standards. We need to do more in the actual workings of the committees and so on of the TCA. If you read the minutes of the TCA committees, they don't really get onto any matters of substance. There should be constant discussions. There are all kinds of things about where the border controls are taking place with France. That's all that is going on, but there isn't a regular dialogue. And above all, I think the British in this context have to say, what is it that the UK can offer to the other members of the EU? The defence cooperation, we probably exaggerate how important we are, but nevertheless, there is something in there, and it extends beyond security in a very loose sense, goes beyond the NATO. And of course, in this world of economic security, there's all kinds of things where we need to be talking. We are on the downside. If we don't do that, we run the risk of being cut out not only of the security dialogues, such as it is if the Biden administration stays in place, with the United States, we run the risk of being excluded from discussions which are taking place in Europe. This EPC conference, which it's not really my area of expertise, is something which really could be important in July. So lots of ways in which the limited possibilities can be built on. And the fundamental things we don't want to do is to say, well, here's our shopping list. Let's wait for the EU to come and follow us up. And now I'm going to give throw a line to David here, because one of the things that people always say, the WTO is completely paralysed, people aren't. But we know a lot of informal things take place at the WTO, which can actually make life a bit better. I'm asking him, which I should, it's not my job. He might have thoughts on what you can do in the absence of formal agreement. So sorry to ramble a bit there.
Thank you. And Mr Hamilton, if you'd like to pick up on that.
Technical difficulty. Okay, there we go. Now it's working. Thank you. That's a great segue. It's very much in the line that I'm thinking. It's very important to remember that just because something doesn't work at the WTO, does that mean it's a complete failure? There's dialogue going on. And so the way multilateral negotiations need to be thought of is they need to be thought of as like rockets. Yes, the first few times it might not get off the ground, but you learn something. And eventually it will happen, but it's a very slow process. But a lot of that is about learning where the problem areas are. And so as I was listening to Peter, I was reminded of the Canada response to basically the Trump presidency wanting to renegotiate the NAFTA agreement, which eventually became what they call the USMCA, and I call CUSMA because I'm Canadian. So, but the thing is everything Peter says, right. The one thing I'll add on that is not to neglect the different levels. So you have the EU level, then you have the national level, and then you've got the companies and corporations. So during the Trump presidency, Canada got very aggressive at going to the state governments like Michigan and places like that, whose competitiveness and whose trade outcomes or domestic outcomes were highly dependent upon access to the Canadian market, receiving those imports. And they were able to go in there and say, look, if we get blocked out, you're going to lose a lot of jobs. And the thing is on that level, both the corporate level and on the state level, Canada was actually able to garner a lot of support and actually justify its position. So when it comes to the laundry list of what you want, you need to go find the people in the European Union, whether it's the countries or the companies, that's to their benefit. Because the thing is, you need an internal voice within that saying, no, this actually makes sense. Having smoother SPS, sanitary, phytosanitary regime between the two countries might actually help. And so when those arguments get made on both sides is when you'll eventually see that happening. But if it's just the UK saying, this is what we want, what do you want, can we agree? Well, you're going to be the very slow process at the WTO. And speaking on WTO resources, I'm actually in the process of preparing a report with Mike, where we're heavily drawing on those. And so when I was a wee intern once upon a time, I actually had to work in what effectively is the auditing division of the WTO, and all members have to be audited. And the UK one will be coming out soon. It's a five-year cycle for the UK. So sometime either this year or next year, I'll have to check the dates. But we're looking at all the other countries of equivalent size, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, in the same situation where there's one very dominant trade partner, and then there's a bunch of other trade relationships that are important to them. And so we're already getting a lot of insights. Right now, we're looking at what the national policies are. And then starting next week, the argument is to go into the free trade agreements and then start to look at what can be learned. But Peter's right. Within the agreements, there are committees actually established on a variety of different files. And it's important to go there to actually with what your asks are, but to charm and say, look, this helps you. That's one of the key things to rebuilding trust is to make sure they understand that actually they're better off working with the UK as opposed to having this other relationship of saying, okay, this is what we want, that's what you want. If they can begin to see that that's to their benefit, and there are a lot of resources, and part of my job is always to go through all those documents that no one reads, whether it's a trade audit or some committee document set up by a trade agreement. Yes, I know how to find those. But I can tell you is that not a lot of people do that work. But if that work is done, and if that's put together with a proper, for lack of a better word, charm strategy, then you'll see the results. Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm just going to mention that in Scotland in October, BSI are also hosting the International Electrotechnical Commission Conference, which will give us an opportunity to engage as a former ISO 9001 auditor for my company. I'm quite excited about that, but hopefully we'll get other politicians interested in engaging with the organisations internationally that will be in attendance there. Mr Stewart.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. What you're describing is a guddle, basically, a guddle of the UK's own making. And if I could turn to your report, and some of the conclusions there. You say that Brexit has had a negative impact on UK-EU goods trade, probably an understatement, I would say. And then you go into some more depth. Cost and administration have increased, goods trade is down, and there are concerns about newly negotiated FTAs. And you say that if unresolved, UK goods trade will continue to suffer with wider impact on livelihoods, economic growth and job creation in already difficult times. You've also stated this morning that it looks unlikely that EU partners are willing to open up agreements again. And you asked the question yourself, I think it was Peter, what can the UK offer? How do we get out of all of this, gentlemen? In my opinion, we should have never left the EU in the first place, but how do we get back in there to a degree to protect industry and jobs here in Scotland and elsewhere in these islands? Mr. Buckley.
I think we do find that the UK is in a difficult position in terms of what we can offer. The obvious point to make, and the obvious, you know, the go-to sector, if you like, is security and defence. One other thing, I mean, obviously the war in Ukraine is horrific, and the fact that, beyond this conversation, the fact that currently Ukraine isn't receiving the support that it needs to win that war is horrific as well, but that's a whole other conversation. But one thing that the war in Ukraine has done is concentrate minds in the UK and the EU. And I think the potential election of Donald Trump in the US later this year is also concentrating minds as well. On the lines of, well, we need to work out who our friends are and recognise who our friends are, and indeed who our enemies are. So I think
Mr. Buckley, can I stop you there? Because I think we all recognise the security concerns, and we have other international agreements around about security, including our NATO obligations. So do you honestly think, because obviously some folks still think that the UK is a much greater military power than it actually is, do you really think that this is a major win, considering that many of the partners that are in the EU are in NATO and separate organisations?
I do think it's potentially a major in for the UK, because we do need to have, essentially, Peter's right, we do need to have something to offer. And indeed, people in the EU have said to me, you know, please don't come to us with your shopping lists about things you don't like with the TCA. I mean, they've used language as blunt as that, because we're not interested. You know, we had a negotiation, we came to an agreement, you signed it, it's set in stone, for the foreseeable future. But the same gentleman did say to me, we are interested if you come and have a conversation and say this is something that we can offer. That cannot only be in security and defence, but security and defence, I think, is going to be a central part of that. Because you're right, the UK's military capability has been eroded, to a degree, because there's been complacency over decades about the peace and security of the world and the fact that things will stay in this period where there is less need for military capability. And obviously the war in Ukraine has changed that, in a heartbeat overnight, sadly. And also our military capability has been eroded over the last 14 years due to government cuts. But nonetheless, if you look at the EU, our military capability, it's not just military, it is also intelligence. And I think we should not forget our significant intelligence ability. It is still very significant within the European context, and is only rivaled by the French ability in terms of military and in terms of intelligence as well. Obviously, Europe is pivoting and is responding to the war in Ukraine and stepping up its game in terms of developing military capability and investing more in security and defence. And obviously, that is to a degree tied to NATO spending. But nonetheless, it is the case that were the UK to have a Labour government in a few weeks, which has stated very clearly it wants a security and defence agreement with the EU, I think that would be an offer that would be warmly welcomed. However, I don't think that in and of itself that is going to make the EU make... We can offer that and then say back, oh, could you please reduce some trade barriers that are present in the TCA, because they're separate concerns. And I think you will have seen lots of speculation about the fact that Labour would want an in quotes baggy or broadly conceived security and defence agreement, in which we would also put energy security, climate collaboration, collaboration on cybersecurity and data and so on. That may be possible. I mean, who knows? We don't know, because it will be changed political circumstances. There will be a new EU Commission potentially later in the year in the EU as well, and a new EU Parliament. So it's only political things that are going to stop that happening. But certainly from the conversations I've had with the people who are currently present in Brussels, that isn't going to happen. And they will look at security and defence in isolation, and they won't want essentially the UK trying to circumvent the TCA by having things in this security and defence agreement that would, that would effectively circumvent it or work around it or undermine it.
So we can have all of these other agreements around about security, around about cyber attacks and other things. That does not mean that the EU will be willing to look at trade once again. And this is what we're looking at here today. What I'm interested in is jobs, the economy, and money in people's pockets, all of which has gone to pot since Brexit. Can I throw back some of the words that you guys have used this morning? Because you have said that the UK is out of sight and out of mind. And you said, one of you said that when it came to certain things, the UK was not relevant. Will the UK continue to be out of sight and not relevant when it comes to renegotiating trade agreements?
I don't think it will, but I think it's going to take time. And I think one of the problems is that we're just not present. You know, we're not in the room. I mean, again, one of the things that people in the EU say to me regularly is that, when Brexit happened, you know, when we left the EU, they were shocked at the degree to which the UK just decamped from Brussels. You know, we didn't maintain a significant presence. We didn't try and make sure there was a UK representative on committees or in discussion fora or things like that. We didn't maintain a strong UK mission. We didn't maintain a strong... To a degree, there is a reasonable business presence, but that's just because businesses have chosen to do that. But they were shocked at the extent to which we just stopped sticks and left. So a new government is, assuming that happens, is likely to change that, but it will, of course, take time. I would imagine that pretty quickly you will get new ministers, assuming a change of government happens, deliberately going to Brussels to have private conversations, but also to do things that are public that say, you know, very clearly to the EU, you know, we're here, we're interested in a conversation, But all of that is going to take time. It's partly about rebuilding relationships. It's partly about negotiating the opportunity for UK ministers or UK representatives to take part in discussions so we're at least aware of what's going on. And it's partly about relationship building and trust building. And there is no shortcut to that. But the other thing that I will say, and you're right, of course, this is a conversation about trade. One of the things that we're doing as a commission is working as closely as we can with different sectors. So for example, we've done a lot of one-to-one conversations. We've got working groups set up in a lot of different sectors, so financial services, energy, creative sector, and so on, because we want to talk to those sectors about the specifics of why the current arrangements are so difficult for them and why they inhibit their ability to trade, to grow, to produce, to employ people, pay wages, etc., to improve people's lives and livelihoods in the UK. But then we also ask, you know, what specific changes to the current arrangements would make things better? And some of them are, what we're looking for, in fact, is things that are relatively small, incremental, specific, so that we can go to the EU and say, or go to the UK government and say, if you ask for these specific things, which are not that major in the context of the TCA or even outside of the TCA, but it would make a specific difference to this sector. It is very piecemeal, but I think that is currently where we are. We're not going to get that big change, let's reopen the TCA, but we might get some piecemeal arrangement changes, okay, which could make a significant difference sector to sector. So there is some hope.
Well, piecemeal and some would say chaotic. I wonder if we could move to Mr. Holmes on some of those questions. I'm interested in what Mr. Buckley said about possibly new ministers going to Brussels and other places in Europe, maybe back in sight, but the UK will still not be relevant, I would suggest. Mr. Holmes, please.
I mean, I agree with what Mike said. I'm trying to be optimistic on these things. So I think, you know, Britain is a big object floating off the, it's not liken it to too many other environmental things, but something out in the sea there that is of relevance to the EU. A failed state in the UK is a problem for the EU, and the raison d'etre of the EU is regional cooperation. It wants to have good relations with its neighbours. And I mean, one lesson I think from recent history would be to look back at the accession negotiations of the countries of Central and Eastern Europe, and in fact a little bit about the history of the Turkish thing. One of the things which the EU looks at in making decisions about how it's going to respond to partners who want a close relationship. What are they doing? One of the first things the UK should do is to stop performative refusals to cooperate. An easy goal for the next government is to say, we're going to get rid of all this ridiculous UKCA thing. They nearly got rid of it. Do things which are obviously in the interests of the UK, which indicate a willingness to cooperate. I remember when been at meetings with German and Polish officials during the accession talk. The Poles said, well, tell us what we should be doing next. And the German officials, former diplomats in this particular case, will be saying, well, you choose what your priorities are and we'll see and judge you by what you're doing. I recall actually visiting Kosovo in December 2008, and a guy, my host, said, you know, next month there's going to be a ban on smoking in all cafes in Pristina. I thought, bit weird. And, you know, that's one of their ways of indicating you're moving in the right direction. So concretely, this will include doing things that we need to that are in our interest, taking part in any discussions that are on offer, building the standards discussions up, extending the conversations in the security field into other areas where there are useful conversations. And in particular, something which I think Mike did mention, carbon border adjustment mechanisms. We're committed to having a similar sort of carbon pricing, a similar regime to that of the EU. There might be some conceivable advantage about some tiny difference. We do a little bit better if we are independent, but we're not independent. And so the idea, the British intend to introduce the CBAM system 1 year after the EU does, and not necessarily make it identical. The first thing one of the first things we should do is talk to you and say, look, it's in all our interest to minimise the frictions at the border, because it's EU importers that bear the direct administrative cost of the monitoring of collecting, ensuring the monitoring of border carbon adjustments, the border emissions data. So we need to go along and say, let's talk wherever we can, where we can do something unilaterally that will improve the situation. Let's just do it unilaterally without saying, can we get something for it? Then wherever there are areas where the EU has indicated there's a possibility for conversation, which is a little bit, we're not quite there yet on CBAMs, but it's the treaty says there shall be discussions about alignment of carbon emissions controls. CBAMs weren't mentioned there, but there's an opening, it's in there. And there's... And the youth mobility. Let's open the dialogues wherever there's an indication, at least even of an amber light, that something's going. And then we can build on other things. Any substantial changes in the relationship would be for the Parliament after the next one, or the very end of this one. But I think there are areas we could move on unilaterally and see what responses there are.
So I'll not take the opportunity to crack a joke about CBAMs, convener. All of this that you're talking about, Mr. Holmes and others, is periphery things in what I would expect to be normal relationships in terms of trying to get cooperation. But none of the things that you're suggesting that happen, and I don't disagree with many of them, are likely to see a change in terms of that trade and cooperation agreement in the near future. And this is what concerns me, and I think concerns many people, because that affects the general public in terms of jobs and the economy and livelihoods. Mr. Hamilton, do you want to make comment, please? I don't think we're getting Mr. Hamilton, convener.
One second. There it is. There's some strange multiple times I have to press the unmute button. Respect to the committee member, it's my approach on this is, I think, similar in line with what you're thinking. What you've heard with your questions to my two colleagues, the responses are addressing what's the dialogue to improve the performance. But as I understand, what you're asking is, what is the performance to improve the dialogue? And so, as I already mentioned, I'm already conducting a research paper with Mr. Buckley. And that's very much the approach, is what are the things that could be done to improve the UK's performance such that when it goes to dialogue, it has a better argument and say why the European Union needs to work with the UK. So this is a very sort of extensive, we're only at the very beginning of this process, but in my opinion, it's a combination of speed and really speed and ideas. The UK, by virtue of coming out of the UK the EU market, can no longer rely on mass, economic mass, to me, is main sort of competitive strength. So it's a question of how do you do that if this was a game like boxing or something at speed, right? So we're looking at a lot of the solutions from New Zealand and Australia that are increase or make things more efficient for companies to get ahead, to be competitive, to make those sales, to employ those people. And some of these things might have existence or might be currently thought of or have some status in the EU pipeline. The reality is the UK has to start really thinking about how does it help a small company do its intellectual property, right? So currently we have identified examples from New Zealand on these sorts of solutions. So all these things that help get ahead of the speed are basically going to put the UK in a position where its dialogue will be reinforced by its performance. Is there a silver bullet to that? No. It's a lot of, if you imagine that wonderful diagram of high effort, low efforts, high yield, low yields, a lot of these solutions, there's a lot of them, but they're in the low effort, low yield, they're all economical, but it requires a lot of diligence. And it's really, I would say, a lot of this is up to the people of Scotland as well as the United Kingdom to ask themselves if they're going to do this. It's one thing for me to write a paper as someone who's coming in from a foreign country to write this, but if no one reads it or no one listens it or looks at the ideas that we identified, then it's just a, you know, not the most greatest value and exercise. But I think at the position, the reality is that the idea that the UK is going to sit down with the EU tomorrow and renegotiate the CCA. No, the question is, if that renegotiation happens, can the UK, through its performance, whether it's with its trade relationships with the European Union or with third parties or with a combination of the two, be able to position itself to get better results? So that's largely the approach that I'm taking. So it's not that dialogue for performance is not important, but you also have to think about what is the performance changes that could be made now to improve future dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you. To use the boxing analogy, I think the UK is on the canvas at this moment in time. Thank you to the panel. Thank you, convener.
Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks very much. Mike, I just wanted to go back to your report, and there was a number of recommendations in there. I just wanted to focus in on two specific ones. So obviously with the chemical regulations, we've got kind of two parallel systems that are working at the moment between the UK and the EU REACH scheme. And then with the EU emissions trading scheme, again, we've got, you know, two systems that kind of relate to each other but are not part of a kind of single market in emissions trading. And obviously there are some issues there in terms of, you know, market size and efficiencies and everything else. I just wondered if you could sort of unpack just what specific changes you think are achievable through a TCA renegotiation on those two particular areas. And if the others are interested, David and Pete are interested in chipping in on that, then I'll take their views as well. But Mike...
Sorry, it was CBAM and REACH that you were interested in particularly.
Yeah, ETS alignment more broadly. And integration potentially.
I think, obviously, it's to look backwards. Obviously, we left the EU, and at the time, there was huge talk of taking down, you know, Brexit, EU red tape, and there was talk of taking advantage of, you know, divergence, and there was going to be the bill that was going to go through Parliament that would rip out lots of EU laws and regulation, possibly to catastrophic impacts on the UK. I mean, we could have lost things like seatbelt regulations overnight, which would have been ludicrous. So obviously that's gone, and the current government rode back from that. And certainly there's no chance that an incoming Labour government, should that be the result of the general election, would pursue such a course. However, we are left with some almost copy and paste bodies or structures like REACH, like ETS, like the CBAT. Some of these will just be, it would just make trade more onerous, complex, expensive. But some of them, I mean, like REACH, for example, I mean, imposes genuinely huge extra costs on business. I mean, so we're talking in, you know, millions and millions of pounds. That, of course, is money that then can't go somewhere else. It can't go on investment. It can't go on wages. It can't go on business growth. And it is just money down the drain. But there is already a lot of money down the drain. I mean, again, I speak to many businesses who have found they're able to continue operating and continue trading in Europe by establishing a subsidiary. But of course, all that's happened. I mean, that's sunk cost now. Even if we were to miraculously rejoin the EU, 6 or 8 weeks from now, which we're not, all of that cost is just gone. So there is that. But I think in terms of the future, what an incoming government can do there will be instances where we would, for example, be able to rejoin the EU equivalent of something that we've created, which is unnecessary. And I hope that an incoming government would choose to do that in as many areas as possible. And certainly those two you would think would be possible. Some of those things would entail EU agreement, but some of them wouldn't. I mean, some of them are just, business related. So if it is just, I was talking to somebody yesterday in manufacturing, and there were a couple of manufacturing related fora which actually are just, they're just business related, so actually we're still members of those because we didn't have to leave because it wasn't a government decision that we would do so. So there may be things like that as well, but anything that is just a needless copy and paste that was done essentially performatively to make it look like we'd regained sovereignty and we were operating differently, but actually just imposing costs on ourselves and our own industries, all of those should be undone in the short term. And I would imagine that business will, and just different sectors will be making that point to government, but certainly we as a commission will be making that point to government as well in the coming months.
Yeah. I mean, does that require a TCA renegotiation, or can some of these issues about alignment or negotiating, say, a Europe-wide ETS, can that just happen separately if both parties are willing to enter into that?
Just happened separately. So, for example, you know, obviously we left Horizon, and then we thankfully chose to rejoin Horizon. We didn't at the same time rejoin Euratom, which is a problem, obviously, for our nuclear industry. So we could, you know, in future seek to rejoin Euratom. I think these things would entail EU agreement, but actually, much as we've said we're out of sight, out of mind, in this conversation, and much as we've said the EU aren't interested in wholesale change, what they are interested in, I think, over the longer term, is in what they would view as a safe manner, drawing the UK back into the EU orbit. You know, they do want us. They formed the TCA in such a way as it would constrict our ability to operate as an independent actor, and we allowed them to do that, and there's a degree to which they will still want that because we're still quite a big economy, and they don't want us operating as a Singapore on Thames or seeking to align too closely to the US model rather than the EU model, which wouldn't particularly benefit us anyway, you know, because they don't want us as a significant competitor. And they've got us where they want us. We can't operate as a significant competitor because if we did diverge too much from EU standards, regulations, or already gone to TCA, they would just impose further trade barriers, which would harm our economy. So we can't do that. That just isn't an option, and it was never going to be an option, really. But nonetheless, there is this desire to draw us back in. But I think one other point to make, which I don't think anybody has made yet today, is that one of the reasons they're sceptical of closer engagement or swift re-engagement with the UK for all the reasons that we've said. Another reason that they are nervous of it to a degree is the fact that they look at British politics and they just, for the last 7-8 years, they just see chaos. And they see, you know, I mean, depending on your view, but this is views that have been expressed to me by many over there. They see a Conservative Party which is, you know, if not far right, is certainly verged towards the populist, and a government that has verged towards the populist. And they, obviously that's present within the EU as well, but they are nervous of closer engagement with that. So we obviously don't know what the impact of the UK election is going to be. But certainly people over there have said to me, you know, you might get a Labour government. That Labour government might be more sensible and it might be more competent and British politics might calm down. But that government isn't going to stay in power forever. And they will be looking at the Conservative Party and wanting to see it come, from their perspective, come back to a more standard, centre-right, sensible point. Because otherwise they will just think, well, we might re-engage with the Labour Party, then the Conservative Party might win 5 years from now, and anything we do with the Labour Party, they might just want to rip up, and there'll be a sovereign government, they'll be able to do that. And they don't want to go around that cycle. So, I mean, who knows? Maybe Labour's going to get a 200-seat majority, and they will think, well, they're probably going to sit there for 5 years, and we can probably, or 10 years rather, we could do a bit more. But they will be thinking this stuff through. And of course, all of that is out of our hands. I mean, that's beyond the question that you asked.
Yeah, but bring it back to the question, the point you're making is that, you know, how much is it worth them investing in, you know, further alignment when, you know, there is that fundamental uncertainty that a new government could come in and just rip it up, or there could be a change in thinking. Okay, you made that point. That's great. Pete, David, do you want to come in on my initial question? Pete, do you want to come in?
Please. A very good point. I mean, I remember in the summer of 2016 visiting the Food Safety Agency, Standards Agency, and they said, oh, we're not worried about how this is going to happen. I expect we'll just be associate members of the relevant EU body, which, of course, they never did. And those possibilities are still there within the framework of the TCA. Commissioners said they don't want to go very far, but there are provisions in it on regulatory cooperation. What that means, we don't know. But there's ways it could be explored. It's not changing the treaty. And for example, how is the UK aerospace industry going to survive? We can be members of EASA, the European Aerospace Safety Agency. There is a provision for non-members. We can join things like that. And for example, on CBAMs and ETS, when the TCA was signed, CBAMs weren't actually on the agenda yet, but it makes provision for cooperation on carbon pricing, carbon regime. So within the TCA, there can be discussions without signing a new treaty or anything like that. However, in an interview on a webinar not long ago, Stefan Fuhrer, one of the EU negotiating team dealing with the UK, said that any mutual recognition on the CBAM front would require a separate agreement rather than something within the TCA. But there's lots of things there which we just haven't explored. These performative, we don't want anything to do with the Europeans. It means there's a whole series of areas. As I say, regulatory cooperation, even if that just means having being at least in the room next door, even if not in the room where the decision is taken, you know, there's lots of things which can be done. And as the previous member said, they won't, in the first instance, make a lot of difference. But there are so many of these Brexit problems which have created, which give us zero value. Our separate reach agreement brings us absolutely nothing. Purely mimicking the EU thing, dynamic upgrading it, won't give cheap, instant access to our chemical producers, but it'll simplify the process. There's lots of small things we can do. And I think the connection between these small things and the big picture goes back to what I was saying about the negotiations between the East Europeans and the EU. The more you're seen to be demonstrating your willingness to be doing the same kind of thing, the more that opens up the movement in the next phase, which we're not actually at yet.
Yeah. No, I think that came across well in your previous answer, Pete, around, you know, the willingness to get in the room and to come with an agenda and to open up to that kind of dialogue. Is the door open then? So if there is a willingness to talk about alignment with ETS or any other detailed policy area, can the right people from the UK get into the room at European level, as you say, even if it's a room next door, and start to bring an agenda into those conversations and to build up that trust and that kind of informal?
I think we can. I mean, technically, there's one small point, which is that alignment itself doesn't get you free access, because it has to be backed up by the conformity assessment and the accreditation. But actually, the more we align, we're seen to be aligned de facto, the more the EU considers as less of a risk. The more, putting it crudely, they'll stop less lorries at Calais if they believe that the UK is actually doing the right things. And the way of guaranteeing that is to actually be engaged in the dialogue. They won't actually get rid of all the border controls until we have a full EEA type relationship. But in the meantime, if they trust brings a lot in relations with the EU.
Yeah, thanks. Any other thoughts, you. David?
Okay, there we go. It takes me several times to unmute myself. I'm just going to further elaborate on what was just said by my colleague, because I very much agree with. When you read Free Trade Agreements, most people don't do that, but yes, there are a lot of little policy tools, a lot of those low effort, low yield things, options that are available but are currently going underutilized. Free trade agreements are not the same thing from 20 years ago. There's been a huge expansion of them, whether it's environment, small, medium enterprise, but you'll see all sorts of new articles. And so I'm trying to think of TCA one. I can't immediately think of the articles, but so I'm going to use the CPTPP. Chapter 20 on the environment, Article 15, Article 18 establishes that basically has a bunch of cooperation articles encouraging not only the government level, the business level, association level, the university level. And one of the reasons why I've returned to universities is to start to become the trade expert that becomes useful using that for biotechnology. That's the goal in my case. And the reality is no one knows how to do these things, and no one uses these. And so this is something new without a lot of solutions. As Peter says, a lot of those small things, I've already said, low effort, low yield. And I'll just reiterate my original point the last time I made. It's a question about diligence. You have to go through this to see what's available in terms of the policy tools, and then start to say, okay, what does this mean? What can we use to get it? If it means University of Edinburgh goes and talks to Haute École de Commerce in Paris, just a bunch of professors. But the thing is that a tool that the UK can use to facilitate those dialogues? As I already mentioned, in Canada, the solution wasn't to go directly bilateral, but was to start going at the lower level, state level, and start to work it way up to get people from those levels to advocate to their own government, and saying, actually working with the Canadians helps us create jobs. It's not stealing jobs. All right, working with the Canadians helps us get ahead on innovation. Working with the Canadians helps us get ahead on environmental goals. That has to happen within the EU. And it's these new articles, these new levers that are in those agreements, no one's using them yet, that are really gonna have to be thought about how to use. And I think the Scottish people and the British people are fully capable of doing that, but it's gonna require the diligence to begin to go through those.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks so much.
I'm looking. Are there any further questions from members? Mr. Bragg?
Thanks very much. Just before I say what I say, if I could just say to the panel, what I'm looking to hear about is what actions you think might be possible for Scotland specifically to take to address some of the issues which you've raised. I'm thinking in particular about Mr. Hamilton's suggestion that the Canadians looked over the border to Michigan to deal with state level, so sub-sovereign state level, but state level in that case, for actions that could make plain the benefit of working with Canada in terms of NAFTA, or whatever the term is that Canadians use. And I should know that. I should say to Mr. Hamilton, I know Nova Scotia very well. I have relatives from Bridgetown and Digby from the time I spent in Prince Edward Island at university. I'm also thinking about what actions are in the Scottish, what Scotland could take independent of the UK relations. And just to explain, I think I completely agree with the analysis of Mr. Buckley about the prospect of any real meaningful change. I mean, talking about the, the reference to a failed state, I think, is very illuminating, and the far right or populist nature of the Conservative Party. On the point about trust, which I think is crucial, if you enter into trade negotiations and a trade agreement which you later admit you had no intention of standing by, then of course that's corrosive towards trust. But there's a statement today by Michael Heseltine saying that there is no prospect of Brexit being discussed by the two major parties during the current election campaign because it's not in their interest to do so. So that again limits the ability to have a realistic look at the real damage which Brexit has done. And I don't have the exact quote in front of me, but he says it's just such an act of self-harm and it's patently obvious it has to be addressed if we're to improve things. So if there is so little prospect of change, and that's, I thought one of the most telling points was the point about whether if you do get a new Labour government, the EU will still look to see, well, what happens in the future. They revert back to another far-right government which unravels these things. So why would it be worth the candle of us, if you like, reaching out and changing some things? And the underlying point about the unlikelihood of a major change to the TCA. So given that pretty grim scenario, which I agree with, I should say, and it's worth pointing out, of course, it didn't have to be this way. Even after the vote on Brexit, there was a choice to make it the hardest possible Brexit and to throw out the single market as well. But given that, what scope for action, if any, do you believe Scotland would have, whether it's companies, its organisations, its government, its parliament, to try and ameliorate some of the effects of this? I think we, at least anecdotally, believe we have a more receptive audience in the EU because, as a country, we voted against Brexit pretty massively. But I just wondered what, in addition to what Mr. Hamilton has said, what else could Scotland do to make sure that the loss of companies, jobs, exports that we've suffered so far can be turned around? And I'll come to Mr. Hamilton first, since I mentioned his example, if I could.
Thank you. I didn't realise I had my mic on still. Great to hear Prince around Bridgetown. So my town was Antigonish, if you've ever went there, and which is a native word. also known as the Highland Heart of Nova Scotia. So it's a very important Scottish town. So right now I'm actually preparing a report, as I said, at trying to answer those questions, right? But both for the UK, specifically for Scotland, it's really a question of, once again, sitting down with the available tools, the new ones that are available. So one of the things that's coming up on the board that I'm writing is this constant conflict between EU performance and then third market performance. And one of the things I've had to establish with people is like, look, if this was a rugby game, the tries is the EU performance, the kick goals is the third party performance. And the reality is that there's a lot of things that could be done there within the realm of global value chains that Scotland could actually be looking at. Because as I already mentioned, it's not just about where you're selling, it's also about what you're bringing in. So one of the things that the UK could, and we were beginning to notice in the statistics and stuff like that I'm looking at, as well as the objectives of all these third-party countries, is all of them, with the exception of one, which is Australia, have an objective with trade diversification. And all of them identify as Europe as a country they want to do more business with. Two, they all have an objective regarding technology and innovation. And all of this is heavily dependent on trade and services. The analysis will be in the report, but I'm just going to have to tease you for the moment. But the reality is that the UK and Scotland are very dominant on trade and services. So starting to look at how these policies align with their own, and maybe to bring in their companies to actually facilitate those objectives to happen for those countries. So I'll give you an example of what we've come up with from Argentina. The United Kingdom sold to the Argentinians agricultural GMO technology on soy, which the Argentinians are growing. They're growing the soy to produce animal feed for the European Union market. So from the UK, there's a services export to Argentina. From Argentina, there's a goods export to the European Union. So what I said, it's about speed. It's about identifying these options, these plays to enhance speed. The other thing is there's going to be a greater need to sort of have dialogue with your own people here, whether it's the associations and things like that. Because the reality is, yes, the government could change tomorrow. But the reality is that if you've got an association of engineers or businesses exploring Europe that gets up and says, we don't care who the government is, we have priorities and we need these things met, and to make sure that they're well informed with the proper analysis and the tools that are available. Like I said, it's a lot of diligence works on many different files. I could talk about this all day, but I'm trying to give you the best examples. And as I said, hopefully in about 2 months' time, we'll have this report ready for you to identify these opportunities. So from what we are looking at right now, we've been identified three categories. One is what the UK or Scotland could be doing to enhance performance outcomes, regardless of who they're trading. Next is solutions that they should be looking at that Canada might have deployed with the United States or Australia with some other country that might be worthy of replication with the European Union to enhance the relationship with the European Union. The third grouping is, of course, the trade opportunities that are available with these third countries that either immediately improve exports or possibly enhance the UK's position or Scotland's within global value chains that also would therefore enhance its position with the European Union. And I said, it's for me, I'm approaching this as performance affecting dialogue, not dialogue affecting performance, but both are important to consider. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mike?
That's very helpful from David, and it's a very good question. I think I would say at least three things. The first is that I think you should have, and you may have this already, a very clear understanding of how the Scottish economy, as opposed to the UK-wide economy, has been affected. So what specific sectors that are important to Scotland's economy have been impacted, and how have they been impacted? So, I mean, agriculture is one that I know has been heavily impacted. Obviously, financial services has been heavily impacted, and there will be others as well. We are, as an organisation, and I can't give you an ETM when this is going to be finished, but we are doing a piece of work on the different regional impacts of our departure from the EU, because obviously the London economy, for example, has been impacted, but less heavily than other regions. So the Northwest has been great, but essentially, as you know, as I think has been, you know, it's fairly common knowledge, the regions of the UK that were poorer prior to our departure from the EU have been worst affected, whereas the regions of the UK, like London, that were better off, have been less badly affected. So as we do that, we will come to conclusions. We will, of course, make those available to you. And that will indicate to us, you know, which particular sectors of the Scottish economy have been more badly affected. Having that information will help you to prosecute an argument to the UK government about what's important for Scotland and Scotland's economy. It will also help you to prosecute an argument to the EU as well. Which takes me on to my second point, which is that you should, and you may do this already, but I would just say be as present as you possibly can as Scotland, as the Scottish government, obviously in London, which you will be, and you will have SNP MPs, of course, in Westminster, but also in the EU as well. And if you can make the point to the UK government that you want a Scottish government representative present when there is a UK government representative present in a particular meeting, forum, you know, ongoing structure, then I would recommend that you do that. They may say no, but they might say yes. You won't know until you ask. The third thing I would say is, if I were you, I would engage as closely as you can with the governments in Northern Ireland and Wales on this, because, of course, to a degree, you have shared interests as devolved administrations and as, you know, three constituent parts of the UK. And obviously, from discussions I have with colleagues in Northern Ireland, they, of course, are in the unique position of having, you know, being present in the UK market and in the EU single market as well. Because Stormont wasn't sitting for such a long period, the people I speak to over there, generally in the business community, but also politicians as well, are of the view that they haven't fully worked out how to take advantage of their unique status. Now, this isn't to say that such a status would be possible for Scotland, because in my view anyway, it's incredibly unlikely, simply because there's no likelihood of a land border, on the island of Great Britain. However, were the Scottish Government to work with, and maybe the Welsh as well, to work with Stormont and the people and businesses of Northern Ireland to enable them to maximise their presence in both markets, that may be something that could be that could benefit Scottish businesses and the Scottish economy as well, if you have a closer partnership with Northern Ireland. And obviously, the geographical proximity of your two nations would help that. So I would recommend those three things: clarity towards the UK government in terms of how the Scottish economy has been affected and different sectors within the Scottish economy, and therefore what changes you want to see in the UK-EU relationship. Be present in the EU and engage with Northern Ireland and indeed the Irish government itself.
That's really helpful. Can I come to Pete?
Thank you very much indeed. I was actually going to suggest you should ask David a few more questions about Canada, because one of the things I've learned is that in Canada, the provinces are actually, directly or indirectly involved in trade policy. So I once had a meeting on Canadian trade policy at Canada House, and there was a representative from the government of Quebec there. They were talking quite happily. The one thing you should be asking is that in areas where you're concerned with the next government, that there should, as Mike was saying, sort of a participation of regional governments in the areas where, in particular, where you have jurisdictional concerns. In the EU itself, as member states, when a matter that came up at the Council of Ministers, which was a responsibility of the lender, we're no longer involved in it. If it's a matter of regional competence, it's a representative of the German province lender that goes to Brussels. So thinking in terms of how you could be doing that, I think is important. And there's something which, I mean, I don't think it's relevant, but it's just worth looking at. In the Canadian context, there are mutual recognition agreements on emissions trading systems between California and, I can't remember which now, Canadian provinces. It was going to be BC, Ontario and Quebec, I think. It may just be California and maybe David could just clarify that.
David? Yeah, I can speak on that because my last job was actually as one of the trade representatives for Nova Scotia. I had a lot of responsibilities. So when, for example, there was a negotiation, when the UK left the European Union, we basically took CETA, copy-pasted, and that's the provisional agreement. And then there was this decision to actually sit down and renegotiate a new agreement. So the number two for Nova Scotia was actually me on that negotiation initially before I left. And of course, now the UK has joined the CPTPP, and then there's been a pause put on the bilateral negotiations. So I don't know exactly the outcome. But the thing is, it's very important to remember that Canada, like the United States, is a federation. So free trade agreements aren't just about tariffs. They're about, as you're hearing, regulations, standards. A lot of that crosses into the provincial jurisdiction. So to understand what happens is when you negotiate with Canada, you have to talk to what's now Global Affairs Canada, which is a foreign affairs department. But what you don't realize is your counterparties on the foreign affairs department, the moment they stop talking to you, immediately have to go into a meeting with all the provinces. And it's kind of this weird four-dimensional negotiation of the provinces, because there's what we want from the party, but there's also trying to figure out what the other position of the other provinces are. My files were environment, government procurement, e-commerce, and a bunch of other ones, and as well as I had the Asia-Pacific lead. So I was responsible for the initial negotiations with Indonesia and stuff like that, but representing the province. On the UK side, I also was because of government procurement, I had to sit in the first government procurement meeting of the provisional committee on the provisional agreement. So I think it was the first one. I don't know if there were follow-up ones, but these are things that we're required to do. So it's the other end of the structure of the Canadian Federation is set up by the Constitution. It's very clear. So there's jurisdictional authority. The devolution approach is a little more difficult, but I think that is one thing that the Scottish government could argue and maybe spend some time learning more about, because it probably does something like government procurement, where it's spending its own money. The reality is that its rules for government procurement are affected by the agreements. There's whole chapters on government procurement. of what's on there. In fact, there's a whole body of knowledge of positive and negative lists, and I'm not going to bother explaining that to you. But the reality is that there are those examples. It's just, I'm sorry, I'm not really familiar, or I don't have the same degree of familiarity with the body legal or constitutional setup of devolution as I do with the Canadian Constitution. So it's a very clear system there. So I'm a little apprehensive from advising too much, but I would advise, yes, there's a lot there that can be learned on, particularly when the jurisdictional area of the Scottish government is being affected by the agreements, because that does create an argument for it to have the equivalent situation as the Canadian provinces in those negotiations. A good example would be government procurement, because the fact is, if you're spending the money and you're being confined to these rules that you have no input into in the negotiations, then there might be a jurisdictional issue that might very well legitimate the Scottish government from coming in, having its negotiators, equivalent to the way Nova Scotia has to send people like me, or used to send people like me when I was doing it, into these strange meetings that you are not aware, but it's a very, very interesting environment. And in addition to that, Canada has an internal trade agreement with an internal trade secretariat. And I also had to represent the province of Nova Scotia on government procurement meeting of that as well. So there's a lot you can learn there, but it has to be done within the context of a legal body of law of devolution, which unfortunately I don't have the same competency as I do with the Canadian Constitution. So I will be reluctant to advise for that situation.
Could I just add one small point that, I mean, I know even less about these details than David does, but there are lots of things that the UK Internal Market Office is an area where you've got, even if the UK doesn't become a federation, there are areas of leverage where you can have a direct input. And so I think the only thing I can really add to all that is, you know, look at all the contexts in which there is need an opportunity for getting into the negotiating process and say we have some competence and jurisdiction in that area, and you know, it's conceivable. This is a complete outlier, but we do have free movement with one member state of the EU, which we usually forget. We have complete free movement of people, GATS mode 4, with the Republic of Ireland. People can move and get jobs, and if you want to recruit people from the Republic of Ireland for to work in Scotland, you can do so. You can't with others, but that's a kind of way of exploring these issues. But I think my main point is there are lots of odd little things which are around there, and even if you can't use what Canada does, see, are there any near equivalents? But anyway, thanks. I think it's a really important question. I'm sorry we haven't been able to go into it in more detail.
No, thanks very much for that. I don't have any further questions, but it would be really interesting if, and I know that the question maybe I've caught you off guard to all three members of the panel, but if you have any further thoughts as to what Scotland could do, can I just say for context, in relation to the examples of Canada and Germany, this so-called most powerful devolved parliament in the world doesn't have anything like the input that the provinces of Canada has with the federal government. We don't have anything like the input that Länder have with Germany. On Mike's point about asking the UK government if Scottish government representatives could sit in with UK representatives, we actually have the reverse of that just now, where the UK government has insisted, when the Scottish government talks to other governments, that the UK government representative must be there. And on the issue of Brexit, Scotland, as with Wales and Northern Ireland, were completely excluded from the discussions and negotiations. So we've got a very highly centralised, controlling unitary state here, which is worth bearing in mind. But if you do have any further thoughts on what Scotland could do, it would be really useful. And the point about Ireland, I think, is an interesting one. I will have to say that if you're enjoying the standards of living that they have in Ireland, which is raced past the standards of living in the UK, why would you want to come to the UK? The opportunities and the standard of living in Ireland is so much better than the UK now. But really interesting responses. Thanks very much.
I'm very conscious of time. We've actually run over when we expected to finish today, but I do have one final question, which I'm looking for succinct answers. It's actually two questions rolled into one as well, which just make it easier. So there's been a lot of talk about the engagement and being in the right room. So I wonder if you could just explain what rooms EFTA countries are in, or are they achieving access to the free market purely through dynamic alignment? And for the room that this Parliament is actually in, I represent, along with my deputy, the Scottish Parliament, as observers at the PPA, although we also have the opportunity to take part. And it was through the work in the PPA that the willingness that Peter mentioned earlier on about youth mobility came as a priority and something we would work on. And of course, the European Commission made that approach to the UK government on the 18th of April, but my understanding is it was rejected by the UK government, but also that the leader of the possible incoming new administration has also rejected that. So does that lead to further sort of engagement and negotiation fatigue from Europe in terms of what UK's priorities are going forward? So if I can have succinct answers, I know that's big questions, but if we maybe go to Peter first. Thank you.
Oh my goodness, I don't think I can really answer that. I think you know the answers better than me. The specific one about EFTA, strictly the EEA, the European Economic Area, where it's not just a free trade agreement, but a regulatory union. And supporters of the... there are people who say Britain should join EFTA and the EEA, which obviously the other members might not agree with, but there are a lot of ways in which they have influence. They're sort of in the room before the final decision is made on a regulation. So I think purely on a regulatory basis, the starting point is actually the standards infrastructure. You obviously know a lot about that, so I don't need to say any more, but through CEN and CENELEC, we are in the room, and the regulations are eventually based on standards. And so it gets, I would say that would be, from a purely technical point of view, a room that we are in and should use. And there's no way that Scottish representatives can officially be excluded, because it's a kind of pan-UK thing. The government doesn't decide. So, sorry, not very helpful, but that's the best I can do.
It's OK. Mike, do you want to comment?
Expert on what rooms EFTA members are in, but as Peter said, they do have a great degree of access and a great degree of influence, although obviously that influence only goes so far. But I think that is something that actually I should find out, and that we should find out, because it would not be unreasonable for the UK to have that as an opening position when it goes to the EU to say these are the rooms that we would like to be in. Though I think incredibly unlikely that the UK would join after all the EEA, because I think it would be a very, very hard sell to the British public politically, because we are then signing up to take everything without having any say, which is one of the things that made all of this problematic in the first place. So I don't really see that as an outcome for the UK. But nonetheless, you are right, they do have access. So I will look into that, and David may know more in a minute. In terms of the UK government and the Labour Party rejecting the offer of youth mobility, I don't think that has any bearing on the future at all. And I think certainly from a Labour Party perspective, that was simply them saying, we don't want to talk about this now, rather than we have no interest in youth mobility. So I would actually be very surprised if 5 years from now there was not a youth mobility scheme in place, which may be along the lines that the EU offered, or it may be something slightly reduced from that. I think they were offering 4 years. And you could start that 4 years up to the age of 30, I think, which is it's arguable that whether somebody 35, apologies to any 35 or 5 year olds in the room, is a youth or not. So it may be something reduced from that. But I don't have any inside knowledge on Labour policy on this, but I would actually be surprised if there wasn't something in place. But I certainly wouldn't read anything into the rejection that was made a few weeks ago.
Okay, thank you. I'm not sure, David, you want to comment on that?
I agree with everything that's said. There's a lot of meetings, and it's very important to be diligent and look at the agreements, to look at what tools are available, because it's not just the government, UK government or the Scottish government. You have to begin to look at the levels that are below you, whether it's universities or business associations, and understanding that getting them to go to the dialogues with their European counterparts and starting to advocate that actually cooperation is far better than this sort of passive aggressive non-cooperation situation. Is far preferable. The only thing I'll add, the most important room to be in beyond that, is with yourselves. So the thing is that my own province, Nova Scotia, is a real latecomer to the trade game. And if you know anything about Canada and the United States, we have a big fight about every 5 years of recycled lumber over a subsidy that's used in almost all the provinces, with the exception of four, one of which is Nova Scotia. And the thing is that when we started doing the diligent homework, we realized that we were being penalized for a subsidy that we did not use. And so we have begun to apply for an exemption to the American tariff when they apply, and we get it. And so this is an example of actually sitting down and doing the work, where instead of actually losing our jobs, actually what happens is we become extremely competitive. And this is a perfect dynamic where the federal government gets really angry at us. And we said, look, we don't use this system. We don't benefit from it. If you want to pay us money to handle the unemployment and the other issues that will happen in our communities, then fine. But if you're not ready to do that, the body of the law, and it's, this is what I mean by digitalists, you have to sit down with that, look at the hard tools and the soft tools that are available. And I can tell people that that starts with meeting with yourselves. And that's how it happens. And that Nova Scotian softwood lumber is a very good example. Small, coming from behind, realizing this is an option. We can ask the Americans for the exemptions, do all the legal paperwork. And they said, yes, yes, here you go. Here's your exemptions, access for you.
Okay, interesting thought going forward, given where we are with exemptions in Scotland. But thank you so much. Very interesting panel. And thank you. The report, we all had a copy of the report, obviously, before committee. And very interesting reading. So thank you for your attendance once again today. And I now move into private session.